We'll go through that and how that's built out, and then Amy will take over and cover just how to create really tailored, really exciting experiences for consumers on websites. So we work with a lot of brands that used to solely engage in one-way marketing. They typically reach consumers by creating content like television ads or direct mailers, and that content was pushed to a target demographic, hoping that it would make an impression and cause the consumer to take an action. So it's no secret that there's a seismic shift occurring in marketing right now. A lot of younger consumers currently do not engage with these channels. So to give you an example, about 60% of my friends in their early 30s don't even have a TV, and they haven't had a TV for over 15 years, and that's by choice. So a lot of these folks are going online and consuming content, but increasingly, you know, a lot of these very same people are getting desensitized to display advertising online and even SEM. If that wasn't enough, there's also a massive shift to mobile. So consumers, more than ever, might never see your ad. So how do we engage these consumers? So one growing way is organic engagement. Consumers who are interested in your brand, product, or services will routinely go on social media channels to find out more information. They're looking for ways to interact with your product through online discussion, riveting content that delivers some value to the consumer, or websites specifically tailored to what the visitor is interested in. There's also an increasing number of channels that are emerging with different ways to engage consumers. There's obviously Facebook and Twitter, but there are newer ones as well, like Vine. You know, to give you an example, it was announced a couple of days ago that Instagram has over 150 million consumers on there. Those are consumers you should be engaging with. So this creates a great opportunity to engage consumers with content. The content can be as simple as a picture on Instagram or a tweet on Twitter. All these efforts should lead to great content on your website that drives consumers to be more educated about your brand and should increase the engagement overall and spur new advocates, and eventually at the end drive sales. So, you know, online two-way social media engagement consists of three easy steps that need to be repeated over time for the best results. The very first step is to listen to your audience and analyze these results. The second step is to publish great, relevant content based on that analysis and engagement, and then also organically engage with that chatter. And lastly, we take a look at how that content performed and we optimize if necessary. So the first step is listening, and to be honest, listening can be really tough. Most of the brands we work with are monitoring on a few different areas. They're monitoring their brand and products, but they're also monitoring their competitors and their products as well. And so when you put these topic profiles into any modern social media monitoring tool, the amount of chatter can be very high. So regardless of what tool you use, we recommend some ways to monitor more effectively. Don't use columns. They tend to be overwhelming, they're unfocused, and it's really honestly hard to keep up. Think hard about a workflow. For example, in this screenshot, we can see that we're monitoring Tesla, but we're not just monitoring all mentions of the car company. We're also showing all positive mentions as well. We can also add other topic profiles right into this stream. And the result is that we can filter down the total number of mentions to something more manageable, which makes us more productive. Do not get bogged down by cost. A lot of tools on the market will charge you by the number of mentions. We see a lot of brands using competing tools. They just stop monitoring. They stop monitoring industry topics. They stop monitoring their competitors because they're terrified that they will run out of mentions or incur some kind of huge overage. This shuts the door to all kinds of opportunities. Look for a vendor that has unlimited mentions. And lastly, on listening, monitor multiple platforms. There are new platforms coming up all the time. At the least, make sure you monitor Twitter, Facebook, Pinterest, Instagram, and YouTube. The more platforms that you can monitor, the more ideas you get about what type of content to create, what type of complaints that you see the most, and who your advocates truly are. Analyze the content. So there's some key analytics we think you should pull from social media monitoring efforts. The first one is impact. This tells you the total number of impressions for a given topic. This gives you an idea if you should focus your efforts on that area. For example, if you're monitoring a competitor's product line and it only gets 100,000 impressions a week, probably shouldn't focus your efforts creating content against that. The next area we think is sentiment. Check to see what the sentiment like is across across the aggregated mentions. If it's highly positive or highly negative, find out why and create content to reinforce positive topics and create content to help consumers resolve their complaints from negative mentions. The last area is advocates. One way marketing is great because you drive the conversation and you're the loudest person in the room. However, in two-way marketing, you are definitely not driving the conversation. It could be anyone. Any modern social media management suite will tell you, will analyze the mentions that you've aggregated and give you a list of advocates that are driving the conversation. A lot of brands that we work with actually reach out to the top 1% of influencers. They make organic relationships. And then this helps in driving awareness, but it also helps when you create content in the future. They will actually take your content when you have these relationships and amplify and promote your content. Once you create your content, based on all the intelligence that you've gathered, it's time to push content out. So your tool set of choice, no matter what you decide to use, should also come with full engagement capabilities. These are not two different tools, it is one. So for example, you know, here at Viral Heat, we monitor topics, we monitor our topics, we engage with consumers, and we publish out new content all in one suite. We highly recommend also that you target your consumers as well. Many social media platforms allow you to publish content and target by demographics. For example, on Facebook, we can target by location, we can target by gender, work, education, and even your relationship status. So if you're targeting folks who might be in the market for a high-end Lexus, why would you target folks who are currently between jobs? So if you target the right content to the right demographic, consumers will engage more with your brand and with your content. Consumers that see a lot of useless content that's not relevant with them, relevant for them, they actually tend to drop off. Another area that we recommend when you publish content is publish to multiple platforms. So using any modern enterprise-grade publishing tool, you should be able to publish to multiple Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn accounts. And lastly, we recommend that you schedule your content. So for example, here at Viral Heat, our editorial teams create content for publication weeks in advance, and we schedule out everything so it's automatically published. So all our feeds appear fresh, and all our content is always available, and our consumers are always engaged with their brand. It really does save a lot of time. So, you know, we spend marketing departments, you know, that we work with, they spend, you know, anywhere from 30 to 40% of their time making content. They also put significant budget into that content. And it's really stunning how many brands have no idea what channel drove traffic, what channel drove sales, and what content was responsible. If there was an advocate that drove that content, who was that? For example, every post that you make should have a unique URL for each platform. Those clicks should all be tracked and tied into your web analytics software. Finally, at the end of the week, we really recommend you look over what analytics, look over your analytics and see where improvements can be made. And most modern social media management suites will tell you what content clicked and what content didn't do well. And so, you know, we recommend at the end of the week you regroup and review that content, and so that at the end of that iteration, you can plan for your next iteration and make content that is actually riveting. So, you know, regardless of what suite you use, yes, there's a few of them out there. We do recommend a unified suite. You know, often brands do fall into this trap of having 20 different tools to actually manage this workflow, and really it should just be one tool. This allows you to scale, and it actually saves you a lot of time because everything is completely seamless. So finally, you know, I just want to highlight one of our consumers that has traditionally been known to do one-way, you know, traditional marketing, and that's Men's Warehouse. You know, they typically leverage traditional marketing, and they leverage their wide network of brick-and-mortar stores. So in the last 2 years, they've gone from completely no social media, no organic engagement, to getting over 2% of their website traffic from social. And the result is you actually get the right consumer to your website. But the next question that a lot of brands ask is, once I have that consumer on my website, the right consumer, how do I tailor an experience on the website that the consumer finds incredibly relevant? And you know, Gigya has wonderful technology that actually helps you do that, and Amy will share a lot of her insights from that experience.
Great. Thanks, Raj. As Kevin and Raj mentioned, I'm Amy Reams. I manage Gigya's Business Development and Strategic Partnerships team. So let's begin by talking about how businesses are leveraging social to acquire customers. As Raj has been talking about, today's consumers are connected more than ever before. And as a result, tons of interesting and evergreen data is stored and updated on social networks. We call this data the digital identity. And unlocking this data set is the key to establishing authentic connections with consumers and providing them with a relevant experience through products and marketing. In these next few slides, I'm going to speak to how marketers can unlock this digital identity. So the best way for a consumer to establish an authentic connection with a business is through social login. As many of you know, social login is the ability for a user to sign up or create an account on any website or application using their social identity. Now, what you might not know is that over the past few years, social login has become the preferred registration method for both consumers and businesses. For consumers, social login streamlines the registration process while significantly reducing forgotten password frustrations. For businesses, on the other hand, it increases registrations by 30 to 40%, and most of all, it gives permission-based access to rich customer data. So if everyone on the phone today is one of more than 50% of people who have logged into an application using a social network, you've no doubt seen an authentication window just like this one here from Facebook. Now, this authentication dialogue is critical for two reasons. The first, of course, is transparency. This dialogue lets a user know exactly what information is being passed to the brand. The second is permissions. By clicking OK, the user is giving consent for businesses to access their information. So with these two elements, transparency and permissions, they help establish trust, which is critical for any type of personalized marketing. So through that one-time request for permission I just showed you, businesses get access to a much richer data set than traditional registration offers. Let's go ahead and compare. So traditional data, as you see here on the left side, are the 2 to 7 fields that are typically captured through standard registration forms. We're all used to these forms, right, with name, email address, birth date, sometimes even gender. But social data, on the other hand, as you see on the right side, offers a much richer data set that can be broken into 4 separate categories. The first category is profile data. So up on the top left there, this is everything captured in traditional registration, plus location, education, relationship status, and work history. Next to that, you see social graph data. This is access to a user's friends, family, followers, and various groups associated with that specific user. Where it gets even more insightful is when you look at the interest data. This is a user's top music, movies, sports teams, books, TV shows, even their favorite brands that the user has liked or shown interest in. And the fourth category is behavioral data. So by tying social plugins directly to an identity, businesses can also acquire activity data, such as shares, comments, as well as purchases. So in order to fully take advantage of social data, we suggest having a database solution with the following features. First, the database must be cloud-based. This makes it possible to easily scale and upgrade with new features over time. The database must also be centralized. This is so that data from multiple web properties or sources can be captured into one specific location. The database must also have a dynamic schema. So this allows for both unstructured data, such as social data, and structured data to be stored with ease. I'll go into more detail about this in my next slide here. So what you're seeing on this slide is that in the past, a relational database was sufficient for collecting and managing traditional, more structured data. Yet now, what this chart's exemplifying is that 90% of the data being generated today is unstructured. Right, so this is everything Raj and I have been talking about, things, data points such as tweets, likes, shares, comments, texts, photos, even friends. And a database that is schemaless is therefore critical, because it allows for the ability to store and take advantage of all this valuable unstructured data. So what does this look like in real life, right? Let's take a look at a case study. You see Forbes here, who, full disclosure, is a Gigya client. And they implemented social login on their Forbes.com web property and saw the following results. After implementing social login, they saw a 100% increase in newly registered users, and 67% of those new registrations came through social login. Even more interesting is that this also resulted in a 60% increase in commenting activity on Forbes.com, as users can now comment more easily by simply authenticating with their preferred social network instead of needing to take the time to fill out a standard registration form. Great. So now that you all have an idea of how to access and store this social data, in this next few slides, we're going to review how that information can be used to power any of your existing marketing efforts. So as Raj mentioned, users are becoming desensitized to banner ads and mass marketing. So rich social data, on the other hand, allows marketers to create specific and varied user segments based on likes, interests, social graph, and specific demographic data. So these unique segments that can be created can therefore be used within existing marketing technologies to finally create personalized, tailored campaigns that are finally actually relevant for end users. Here's an example of an email marketing campaign that could be triggered by updates a user makes to his or her social profile. So what you're seeing here in this example is this user, Claire, has updated her status on Facebook to engaged. Now, as a result, this information is automatically updated in the database, as Claire has already authenticated with the retailer using her Facebook identity. So now that said online retailer can send Claire an email suggesting wedding gowns, as she is clearly now in the market for such an item when maybe a few months ago she wasn't. Here's another example that follows up on Roger's example of an ad serving campaign. So in this example here, the publisher, PGA, identifies that this user of theirs fits into a specific target demographic. They're noticing that user is between 35 and 60, likes high-end brands such as Bentley, private jet company, Gulfstream, watches TV shows like CNN Money, for example. So therefore, PGA can serve this user a Lexus ad, as it's clear from his profile information that this user is in Lexus's target demographic. This third example shows how a retailer like Victoria's Secret can recommend content based on social interests. So again, you're seeing an identity or a persona of a user up in the top left. This persona of the user is sporty, as we've been able to identify that they like the Nike Women's Marathon. They like yoga, as well as brands such as Lululemon. So then a retailer like Victoria's Secret, instead of recommending any product in their product catalog, can specifically market their workout line, right? In this example, they've shown their running pants here, as they know that's a good fit for this user's daily likes and interests. So rounding it out before the Q&A, I'm going to cover some ways that a business can also make their own web or mobile experience more engaging through various social technologies. So due to the growth of social networks, users are now expecting to be social wherever they go on the web. So as a result, for businesses like yourselves, this requires you to build your sites and applications to be social from the ground up. So this slide here specifically showcases some of the examples of how you can make your own web properties more interactive and meaningful through various social plugins such as reviews, gamification, comments, and shares. You can also see that social login is at the core, because identity plays a big role when it comes to increasing the authenticity of the content within these specific plugins. I'll walk through a few of these examples to give you a better understanding of what I'm talking about. So first, you're looking at ratings and reviews. By integrating ratings and reviews or commenting if you're a publishing site, it's an ideal way to let consumers express opinions and join in the conversations about your content. It also helps visitors feel that they're part of a community of individuals with similar interests to their own. A few best practices to keep in mind if you're implementing ratings and reviews is to use social login to authenticate the user in order to decrease trolling and decrease spam. When doing this, remember, just keep it simple. Having a lot of barriers to post a review will inevitably result in less user contributions. And last but not least, allow users to share reviews to social networks. This contributes to your other marketing strategies, such as referral traffic and SEO. Another way to increase engagement is to surface relevant content with an activity feed. You're seeing here, activity feeds allow users to see what types of content people on the site are engaging with. A few best practices, again, are to make this social, right? So don't just highlight any activity, but highlight activity from a user's social graph that you've collected through social login, showing them what their friends or connections are doing on the site. Furthermore, surface trending content. For example, most shared, most commented, most viewed articles and content pieces on the site. Now, in order to increase the frequency and value of valuable actions such as shares, reviews, and purchases is through gamification. So gamification is a method of loyalty that uses rewards like points, badges, and levels to incentivize users into taking such valuable actions. For example, you can create actions and challenges around users who generate the most referral traffic back to your site, or who make the most purchases in a certain time frame. Let's look at a case study to see how this can be done. So this is Capcom, another Gigya client, and what they did was they incorporated gamification into their promotion of their release of the Devil May Cry video game. So some more insight into that is that they actually came to Gigya generally because they wanted to increase awareness of the new release. So they rolled out a mobile application where users were rewarded for partaking and completing missions that were created by Capcom. So for example, this included a photo sharing mission where points earned within the gamification experience were directly tied to your points within the Devil May Cry game itself. And as a result of creating this engaging gamified experience, they actually saw thousands of daily logins on their mobile app. They saw an increase in loyalty with the average user returning to visit the game 6 times. It also contributed directly to their bottom line because they saw over 1 million game sales in the first month after launching this specific app. Great, so rounding it out, as Kevin mentioned earlier, Gigya offers a connected consumer management suite. It's an end-to-end solution to help businesses establish authentic connections with consumers, and it includes all the tools and technologies on both the front end and back end to allow a business to connect with their consumers, collect and manage customer data, and convert insights into actionable marketing. We work with over 700 clients, some of which like Forbes and Capcom I showed you here today, but this includes 45% of the Comscore top 100 web properties, and our technology actually reaches 1.5 billion consumers monthly. We were recently named 2013 ZDNet CRM Watchlist winner, as well as we're the winner of the CRM Rising Star Award. So please feel free to reach out to info@gigya.com with any questions. I'll shoot it back to you now, Raj.
Yep, and Viral Heat is a social media management platform. It's a complete unified suite. We manage social media infrastructure for over 20,000 brands worldwide. That includes complete, you're able to come in, completely connect your social media infrastructure, engage at scale, do all your targeted demographic publishing, and then also do all the reporting as well. Secondly, we also do social media monitoring at scale for our 20,000 brands worldwide. We do about 7 billion mentions per week, and we're able to deliver those conversations right into your workflow, and we're also able to do all the reporting as well on that. So for more information about Viral Heat, you can always contact sales@viralheat.com. All right, so we're going to take a quick break here and get started with questions in just a couple seconds here. So actually, I wanted to start off with just one question that we got, which is for Raj.
And the question is, I run a marketing agency and we manage multiple social media clients, or multiple social media accounts for clients. Are there some best practices around data and account security that you can offer?
Yeah, this is something that is one of the fastest growing use cases for social media management. A lot of our clients now in the financial sector or in the health sector are bound by law to make sure that their social media infrastructure is secure. If that social media infrastructure is not secure, it could actually result in fines. And so ViralHeat does have full team and seat and compliance management. You're able to come in and connect that social media infrastructure to ViralHeat in the context of an organization. And that way you don't have to share your credentials, share the actual Twitter or Facebook credentials with your team. And then you can actually set compliance and then invite team members. So, for example, if someone else leaves your team or leaves the company, you can simply remove them from the organization and your social media infrastructure stays secure. So I would, whether you're using ViralHeat or some other third-party vendor, I would make sure that team and seat management and compliance is fully baked into the suite.
Okay, thanks, Raj. So I have another question around privacy and security, and this one's for Amy. Amy, the question is, how should marketers address privacy concerns around social data capture?
Sure, yeah. You know, it's a good question. It really is a good cast to what Raj was just talking about. The short of it is it's not as hard as you think, right? As a marketer, again, it's all about transparency. So when accessing social data, you just need to be sure to be explicit about what data you're capturing and how you're planning to use this. Right, make sure the user's opting in to receiving emails from your brand, as one example. Also continuously be sure to display this data back to your users over time. Right, one way some of our clients do it is simply through a user profile, where a user can go in and edit their data as they see fit, edit the way they want to be marketed to, or the social networks they've connected to that account. Again, it all feeds back to transparency.
Great, thanks, Amy. So this next question is for Raj, and it's just a simple question on ViralHeat. So what social platforms does ViralHeat support?
Yeah, we support Twitter. We support all we support the management of Twitter for Facebook, Google+, Instagram, and LinkedIn corporate pages, groups, and your personal account. On the monitoring side, we do monitor Twitter, Facebook public status updates. We're also monitoring 65 million Facebook pages, Instagram, Pinterest, web, and viral video sites such as YouTube, Vimeo, and Dailymotion.
Hey, thanks, Raj. So another one for Amy here. So do you find that the use of social login is growing for your customer base?
Fantastic question. Absolutely, it's growing, not even for our customer base, but simply across the web generally. About 2 to 3 years ago, I think it was around 10% of users that would register with the social identity. Now, though, we're seeing about 30 to 40% of users that register actually actively choose social login as their method of choice. And we did a large survey at the end of 2012 as well with a third party, and we actually found at that time that over 50% of adults have registered with a social identity. So I'd imagine now, almost a year later, that number has continued to grow as well.
Great, thanks, Amy. So I got another one here for Raj. So within our company, marketing, sales support, and other departments use social media. How can we manage these multiple departments accessing our social accounts? We'd love to use a single platform. Is there like a unified way to do so?
Yeah, it's back to the first question about team seat management. You can definitely create each department can be in the context of ViralHeat can be an organization. You can connect your social media infrastructure to that organization, set up compliance, and then invite team members. Yep.
Well, and then another follow-up question for you, Raj, is does ViralHeat support mobile at all, asked by the same person?
Yeah, we do have an iPhone application, and you can actually take your entire ViralHeat workflow that includes all your smart streams, all the analytics, all the engagement, it can actually be put on the iPhone, and that experience, you can have that experience on your phone.
Okay. So this next one's for Amy, and it's how does Gigya connect with third-party marketing applications? I think the question is more like how do you push that data to third-party marketing programs?
Sure. Yeah, no, good question again. Gigya mainly does this through our Nexus partner program. So I encourage you to go to our site and take a look at the Nexus Partner Program. What we've essentially done is build out a number of pre-built integrations into existing marketing tools. So this includes folks like Viral Heat, as well as email marketing platforms like ExactTarget, for example, or on-site recommendations engines. The idea of this is that it allows a business more easily without devoting tons of development resources to view and utilize the data captured through Gigya within these existing tools. So please do take a look and reach out if there's further questions on that.
Okay, thanks. And just one final question here, and it's for Amy. And the question is, hold on 1 second. Okay, what is the suggested amount of social networks to offer when implementing social login?
It's a good question. Honestly, it'll depend quite a bit on, you know, your different vertical. Our client services team works with you on it, and we typically recommend about 3 to 6 networks to give users choice when registering with your site. We actually recently just put out some stats on our blog, so feel free to check out the infographic. But one thing we found with that was that it did depend vertical to vertical, right? So across all of our clients, about 52% of registrations came through Facebook. For media and publishing sites, that dropped down to about 44%, as Google Plus was closer to 30 for that. So again, depends on verticals, but you certainly should give at least 3 networks as a choice.
Great. And one more question here for you, Amy. Is there an agency program where we can build and manage sites, sites and apps for blue chips?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think that's something we might want to take offline. So I'll be sure to reach out to understand a bit more. We do have an agency partner program, but I'll need to learn a bit more about your needs. So I'll reach out to discuss it.
Okay. And one more question here for Amy, which is how do you do age verification for social login?
Yeah, good question. So some of the social networks do actually offer age as something that comes back. So there's 2 ways that we look at that. One, as a permission, if age is just generally passed through the social network. Google Plus as well as Facebook both offer this. On top of that, we do work with some third parties, Secure and Trulio, as examples that help verify that the age put in on the social network is the actual age of the said user. So again, happy to get into more detail on that for your specific use case.
Okay, thanks for all that, and I think we're going to end it right here. And if you have any follow-up questions, you can always reach out to info@gigya.com or sales@viralheat.com. Thanks again for attending, and again, we'll be providing a recorded version for you via email in the next 24 to 48 hours. Okay, thanks. Bye.